Welcome to Fringe Pop 321, the show that believes the world is stranger than we think, but thinking should not be strange. It's well known that people who assign sacred status to the Bible overwhelmingly believe in the divine creation of all that is. The universe, the world, and all life forms in the world and the universe known or yet to be discovered. Typically, the reference point for that idea is Genesis 1, 1 through 3, which reads as follows, and this is the New King James Version. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. Now, creationism, as this belief is known, takes various forms. There's young earth creationism, old earth creationism, progressive creationism, evolutionary creationism. These are just examples. All views of creationism, though, must account for evil and death in the world that the Creator made. The Bible describes a fall of humanity in Genesis 3, prompted by the serpent, understood as Satan, from which human death was the result, according to the book of Romans chapter 5, verse 12. But the Bible is silent on when Satan became an evil rebel. The Bible omits other things in its account of the early earth, things that people in the age of scientific progress wanted to know about. Long geologic ages and the fossil record are two examples. When those things became known, people who had a high view of the Bible wanted to know, hey, where is that stuff? How can we account for this new information? Now, many creationists today explain fossils and animal life killed that created those fossils as occurring during the Great Flood. But the flood doesn't address the millions of years in geologic ages. The flood lasted a little over a year. Some deny, though, that those millions of years are valid at all. Others say the millions of years, believe it or not, are in the Bible. You might wonder, well, where in the world would I find millions of years if we don't have it in the flood? Where would I go for that? Well, in the minds of some Bible believers, the millions of years and the fossils can be explained by a series of events that occurred between the first two verses of Genesis 1. That's literally reading between the lines. In this gap of time, one of the members of God's heavenly host, we're told, one of the angels, became Satan, having been expelled from heaven to earth for rebellion against God. On earth, Satan corrupted creation so that God had to destroy it. Consequently, the original creation in Genesis 1:1 became a ruin. Its state is described in Genesis 1:2 as formless and empty, engulfed by darkness. And so we insert all these things in this gap between those first two verses. Then God had to recreate everything in Genesis 1:3 and so on. Now, this idea is known as the gap theory of creation. In our topic today, we're going to ask a simple question. Is the idea valid? Well, let's find out. Let's unpack the gap theory a bit. Because they view the fall of Satan and the destruction of Earth as the way to explain the entrance of evil and death into the world, gap theorists want to translate the first two verses of Genesis 1 a bit differently than you just heard a few minutes ago. Earlier, I recited the New King James translation of Genesis 1, 1 and 2. And most English versions sound pretty much the same. Here the two verses are again. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep. Now, gap theorists want to translate the first two verses of Genesis this way. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth became without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep. There's one word changed here, but it's crucial. Verse 2 has the earth becoming. It became without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep. Now, that wording suggests something occurred after verse 1, but before verse 2, to sort of change that circumstance. That something, according to the gap theory, is Satan's fall and the corruption of the earth and God's wiping the slate clean. This cataclysm, gap theorists argue, explained both the fossil record and the presence of Satan in God's creation. God had originally created everything wonderful, but it became without form and void. And the darkness indicates to the theorists that these conditions were caused by something awful and sinister. The long ages of time that scientists insisted on for the early Earth were what they were because God took a long time before deciding to recreate the Earth in Genesis 1:3 with the pronouncement, "Let there be light." So by way of review, we have a gap between Genesis 1:1 and 1:2. Something happened in there so that in verse 2, the Earth became formless and empty and again engulfed by darkness. And then God decides to recreate everything in verse 3. Now it should be clear by this point that positing a gap between Genesis 1:1 and 2 and a restitution or recreation of an earth destroyed by Satan in that gap, beginning in Genesis 1:3, that all of that presupposes that Genesis 1:1 through 3 describes a linear chronology or a linear sequence of events. The problem is that Hebrew grammar explicitly rules that out. Now, Biblical Hebrew, the language in which Genesis was written, has a way of denoting events in sequence and a way of stopping a sequence. In simplest terms, the normal way of narrating sequence is to prefix a one-letter conjunction, the vav, it's spelled W-A-W but pronounced vav, prefixing that one letter to the verbs that occur in succession. In Hebrew grammar, this narrative sequencing is called the vav consecutive, or the vayiktol sequence. I've made a search of Genesis in my Bible software for this grammatical structure to show you how common it is in Genesis 1 and to show you where it doesn't occur. I've asked the software to detect any consecutive verb structure, which means the verbs that show sequence, and highlight them in red. Now here are the results. Basically, everything in Genesis 1 is a narrative sequence, and here's the key thought, beginning with verse 3. The first two verses, and most importantly for us in this topic, Genesis 1:2, are not set as a sequence of events by the writer. They are instead a set of conditions that are present for God's announcement in verse 3. Now, this isn't a lesson on how to do exegesis in Genesis 1. What's important for us is to establish that there is no linear sequence between the first three verses. We don't have a chronology of events. Now, the writer did one more thing to make sure we don't read a sequence in these first three verses. He used the reverse of the vav consecutive verb pattern in Genesis 1:2. He put that small vav conjunction on a noun that begins verse 2, interrupting the sequence of the vav plus the verbs. That's called a vav disjunction. Now, you can't see this disjunctive vav letter in the English translation because it's usually not translated at all in English Bibles. Here it is in an interlinear Hebrew English Bible. You can see the small little letter there with the arrow pointing to it. That is the vav disjunction. This is why the Hebrew grammar forbids a linear sequence of events. Now, this grammar in turn also rules out a translation of became for the Hebrew verb haya, the to be verb, without form and void in Genesis 1:2. Recall that in the gap theory, they want to translate Genesis 1:2 as the earth became formless and empty. Now, the problem again is that wording requires a transition from an original creation to some tragic circumstance, and transitions depend on a linear sequence of events. In other words, there can only be a before and an after if there is a linear sequence. One thing can't become another without a linear sequence, and if we don't have a series of events in the first three verses because of the grammar, we can't say that something became something else from a previous state. It's not an overstatement to say that the Hebrew grammar we just looked at kills the gap theory in its tracks. But the gap theory has other lethal problems that I want to mention. Gap theory reasoning posits a judgment of Satan between Genesis 1:1 and 1:2. That, of course, presumes Satan became evil, rebelling against God between those two verses. The biblical text never says anything, anywhere, about when the divine being we know as Satan became corrupt. The gap theory, therefore, is literally a theory built on nothing but silence. Now, some gap theorists point to Revelation 12, the war in heaven passage, to justify their idea. But if we read that passage, verses 4 and 5 of that chapter make it very clear that what prompts the war in heaven is not Satan or creation or something like that. It's the birth of the Messiah, which happened long, long after the creation. Revelation 12 is not about a pre-Adamic or pre-fall fall of Satan. Gap theorists also argue that the wording of Genesis 1:2, where the earth is described as without form and void, or formless and empty, depending on your translation, suggest a condition of judgment, despite the fact that Genesis never actually describes a judgment. But gap theorists think that they can support the idea. You might ask, how? Well, the English phrase in Genesis 1:2, without form and void, tohu vabohu, occurs elsewhere. Now, tohu has the meaning of wasteland or emptiness or nothingness, and the reasoning goes God wouldn't create things that way, so it has to describe a judgment. And there are two other passages, Isaiah 34:11 and Jeremiah 4:23, where this word pair, tohu vabohu, without form and void, occur together, where there is a judgment context. Now, that's important to see and important to really think about. Here's the issue. Just because the two words are used in other places, other passages where a judgment has occurred, doesn't mean that the context of those other passages should be imported into Genesis 1. Each passage has its own context. So whereas other passages might describe a judgment and use those two words to describe the results, Genesis 1 doesn't do that. There's no judgment described in context in Genesis 1. And lastly, even darkness cannot be construed as necessarily evil. The Bible says in several places that God dwells in darkness. 1 Kings 8:12, 2 Chronicles 6:1, and 2 Samuel 22:12. The point in those passages is that God cannot be seen unless he wants to be seen. So just because Genesis 1:2 mentions darkness doesn't mean something sinister or evil is in view. The presence of darkness is no argument in defense of the idea, therefore, that Satan rebelled between those two verses. So in the final analysis, there isn't a single text-driven data point that supports the gap theory, either in Genesis or anywhere else in the Bible. Creationists will use other methods and have other arguments for resolving the problem of evil and death and the fossils and so on and so forth. But for our purposes here, the gap theory is just not valid when it comes to sound exegesis and, specifically, Hebrew grammar. And the Old Testament was written in Hebrew. Thanks again for watching Fringe Pop 321. Please visit our website for episode information on this topic and the other episodes that we do and the other topics included in Fringe Pop. If you're interested in supporting what we do at Fringe Pop, please go to fp321.com/S as in Sam and make a donation. And come back and watch more episodes and tell other people about the channel, because what you know may not be so.